good thing about music, when it hits, you feel no pain. It's the first Friday of Reggae Month 2020, and reggae music is the language of the day. In today's Jamaica Magazine, we take you on a musical and historical expedition. Our first stop is at one of the birthplaces of reggae, the Trenchtown Culture Yard. We will then witness the creative representation of reggae through film. Then our indigenous dances will have us grooving. Stay right there. We don't want you to miss a beat in today's rhythmic journey.
Reggae Month 2020 is here, and a host of activities are in store across the island. Echoes of Sound Systems, Reggae Wednesdays, Reggae Gospel Concert, Bob Marley's 75th birthday celebrations, Daria Honors Award, Reggae Film in the Park, Children of the Icon Store Concert, and more. Keep up to date on all the activities. Download the new Reggae Month mobile app. Simply search the words Reggae Month Jamaica in the Google Play or App Store. The app will also allow you to add and promote your own Reggae Month activity. So what are you waiting for? Download away and make use of this innovative technology today. Reggae Month 2020. Come catch the rhythm.
Today, I am Stephen McHugh, and this is your GIS News for Friday, February 7. Government is implementing several measures to supply communities island-wide with water during the current period of drought. The Meteorological Service of Jamaica reports that the country will be experiencing near-normal rainfall in some areas and moderately dry conditions up to at least April. Minister with Responsibility for Water, Pernell Charles Jr., says the multi-sectoral approach to drought management being undertaken is to minimize the effects of the dry period on Jamaicans. A drought management committee, an arm of the Integrated Water Resources Management Council, has been established to manage the execution of the plan.
Drought management plan also has within its components drought response activities that are aimed at the rapid intervention for the prevention of loss of lives, protection of health, prevention of loss, of course, of livelihood and property.
Minister Charles Jr. was speaking at yesterday's press conference on drought mitigation at Jamaica House. The committee is chaired by the Office of Disaster Preparedness and Emergency Management. It consists of representatives from the National Environment and Planning Agency, Rural Agricultural Development Authority, and the Ministries of Health, Local Government, and Economic Growth and Job Creation. Approximately 26 rural water system projects will be completed for 2020, 18 of them by March, and the remaining 8 by June. This will provide water to an additional 56,000 Jamaican residents. Senator Charles Jr. says 38 schools will also be fitted with rainwater harvesting systems by March, and more trucks will be bought to distribute water to the hardest hit areas.
And during the drought period, the fee for sterilization is proposed to be waived, something which several truckers that we have interacted with and engaged has indicated as one of the obstacles to them doing more trucking.
Steps are being taken by government to increase security measures at Cornwall College in St. James. This follows the recent assault of the school's dean of discipline by a parent whose child was being bullied. The news was revealed by Minister of State in the Education Ministry, Orlando Terrylong, during a recent visit to the institution.
One of the things that we'll be doing at the ministry level is doing an estimate to see what sort of, in terms of surveillance system can be installed here at Cornwall College. You know, we recognize that our teachers, you know, that they are an important part in nation building. You know, there can be no growth, development, and prosperity without our teachers.
Since the incident, the ministry has met with the school board, parent teachers association, and police to put other security measures in place. He assured students, teachers, and the principal that their safety and security were of paramount importance to the government.
So it was important for us as a ministry to stand with our teachers, to stand with our principals, and say this sort of behavior, this sort of violence that happened here, it must never happen. It must never, ever be repeated.
The incident at Cornwall College is the second such assault against a teacher in the parish within a week. A teacher at the Dumfries Primary School was allegedly attacked and injured by a parent because his child's book was not marked. Starting this month, the services offered by the Transport Authority will be done through a cashless system. Transport Minister Robert Montego says this is to ensure a safer and more efficient system.
We're going cashless, we won't be collecting cash, so no more $5,000 bill and $1,000 bill and $100 bill and $500 bill. Are the coins, no more cold hard cash. You have to pay with your credit card, your debit card, or you go to Paymaster, or Bills Express, or NCB, or Scotia.
Minister Montego was speaking on Tuesday at the Transport Authority and Hope National Service Corps Drivers Training Launch. The Transport Ministry is also planning on adding more financial institutions to this arrangement in the near future. The closed season for Queen Conch is now in effect until March 31, 2020. This was declared on February 1 by Agriculture Minister Audley Shaw in an effort to protect the industry. During this time, it is illegal to catch, sell, or process any conch meat. Conch meat that was previously declared must remain in cold storage until the season officially reopens in April. It is also illegal for any person to catch queen conch and or harvest any conch products, whether it be the shell or conch opercula. The ministry is appealing to and warning against breaches of the regulations and urges stakeholders to help safeguard the livelihood of thousands of Jamaicans involved in the conch industry. And finally, the Jamaica House Basic School has received much-needed books, learning aids, and other supplies courtesy of the Optimist Club of Kingston and Lady Allen. Representatives of the club and Lady Allen handed over the educational materials as well as snacks to the school on Thursday. Lady Allen stressed the importance of reading as an integral aspect of learning.
It's very, very important that all our boys and girls learn to read. So we want to encourage you to start reading. Your best toy is your books.
The initiative formed part of the club's observation of International Optimist Day, which was held under the theme, Just Imagine. Principal of the Jamaica House Basic School, Veronica Parkinson Burnett, expressed gratitude for the gifts.
This is a welcome theme. Imagine what would the world be without us. And so I just want to say thanks to the Optimist Club and thanks to our Honorable Lady Allen also for partnering with us. And we hope that this is the beginning of a long and lasting relationship. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
And that's it for JIS News Today. I'm Stephen McHugh. Thanks for watching.
Protect yourself from the flu virus. Visit your nearest health center or doctor to get the flu vaccine. Cover your mouth and nose when coughing and sneezing. Wash your hands regularly with soap and water or by using an alcohol-based hand sanitizer. Avoid the spread of germs by not touching your eyes, mouth, or nose. And be sure to regularly disinfect surfaces and objects that are used often. Remember, your health is your responsibility.
Up next, we take you on a lively tour to the island's first inner-city heritage site.
Some call it the Hollywood of Jamaica, while others refer to it as the cradle of Jamaica's music. This place is packed with history, and lucky for you, we will be exploring some of it today.
This culture is a museum, you know. And it's a history of Trench Town. It has a whole lot of legacy in it.
Yes, the Culture Yard, which is situated at Lower First Street in Trench Town, is one of the many houses built by the Central Housing Authority between 1940 and 1949. These government houses were built on 200 acres of land and subdivided to facilitate a residential community to be called Trench Town.
Trench Town itself, it was named after a person. And the name of that person is Daniel Power Trench. Daniel was born in Jamaica. His mother was Jamaican, but his father was an Irishman. So Daniel's father came to the Caribbean, basically, to the business, and he met this woman. They got married and had 14 children, and there comes Daniel. Greenwich Park Estate Land, that was the name of the estate that was owned by Mr. Trench. And what had happened was, before Daniel died, you know, he was born 1813, he died 1884. He actually left that land, the estate land, to last his family at least 99 years. And what had happened was, there was a huge earthquake in 1907 that had destroyed the estate land beyond repair. So later on, the land became a squatter settlement. You had persons who started to squat on the land. And afterwards, now you find where the government came in and had asked the family to sell the land to them. So it was sold to the government, and that's when the government now divided the land in different areas.
On the land, the government built four different blocks of houses, namely H, S, T, and U block. On the U block is the Trenchtown Culture Yard. People travel from near and far to learn about the phenomenal history of Trenchtown and the successful people and musical bands it has produced, such as the Heptones, Abyssinians, and the Wailers. Within these walls, visitors also get to observe furnishing and instruments used by the musical icons who once lived here, including the great Bob Marley and his mentor and co-writer, Vincent Tata Ford.
So Vincent Ford, this is all his writings on the wall. This is him, this is his furniture, this is his Bible.
It was in this space that the popular Bob Marley hit, No Woman, No Cry was penned. In this song, listeners are able to get a feel of some of his experiences while living here.
His first vehicle of what he owns, his first acoustic guitar, the single bed of what he sings about also is there. And there are many bits and pieces of Bob that is still here.
It's emotional.
After an emotional tour of the rooms and galleries, visitors get the chance to wander the courtyard, where they will find this fascinating statue of Bob. And this captivating mural of the culture tour. But the tour of the culture museum and yard is just one of three tours available to visitors.
So normally we offer three different tours. The tour one is just inside the culture yard itself. You get a guided tour with one of our tour guides, and it's just a tour inside of the galleries. We offer a second tour. That tour takes you to where Bob Marley's mom lived when she came here in 1956 and Bob was only 11. So that house is basically not just Bob Marley's mother's house, but it's also where Bonnie Wailer lived. Because, you know, Bonnie Wailer and Bob Marley, they were stepbrothers and they share the same home. We also have different craft shops in the area where some old persons can make their own money. So the guides would walk with you there. There's also Trenchtown Ceramics, where the persons, they make ceramics out of our own Trenchtown clay. And at the end of that, it stops at the recording studio that we have in Trenchtown called the Jamming Studio. So there, you know, persons, you know, the guests get an experience of how the rhythms are made.
It's evident that the Culture Yard is a must-see for anyone who wants to learn more about Bob, Jamaican music, and the phenomenal evolution of Trenchtown. It's no wonder the site was declared Jamaica's first inner-city heritage site. The venue opens every day, 9:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Mondays to Saturdays, and 10:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. on Sundays. To arrange your visit or guided tour, all you have to do is contact tour manager Sophia Dow at 876-859-6741.
Trust me, you don't want to miss out on this rich cultural experience.
So many wish they could visit our shores. We live where they vacation. Brand Jamaica beckons all from the four corners of the earth.
Well, as a Jamaican, I have great pride in selling it. You know, your pride that you sell Jamaica with is something that it rolls off. Jamaica has so much to offer. And every time I have the privilege of bringing an executive down to Jamaica, an executive from an airline or a tour operator or a travel agency, and you take them across the country, You know, the pride that they said, wow, I can't imagine, especially when it's their first time. Wow, I love this.
Build it. Cherish it. Our wealth is Brand Jamaica.
Reggae Month kicked off just a few days ago, and already a host of dynamic, edutaining activities have been taking place across the island. One of the events which is slated to take place on Fridays is the Reggae Films in the Park series at Emancipation Park. Here's a recap of last year's staging and a reminder of why you just can't afford to miss it this year.
Oh yo, the race is gonna start, you know.
Jesus Christ, it's my wife Sharon. Listen, run, go around here, so run.
Go down the sugar hide, I'm a husband.
No, we are not at Carib Cinema. Arts Page comes to you this week from the capital's Emancipation Park, being entertained by the visuals put to the infectious beats of reggae. Among the calendar of activities organized by the Culture Ministry in celebration of Reggae Month is a weekly session of free films at Emancipation Park. The Lenses started projecting last Friday.
Presenting some films in Reggae Month that epitomize our reggae industry. There were more than 150 reggae festivals around the world, and the people who go to these festivals want to know more about the reggae artists who perform, who make the music they buy and listen to. And so they've made films, many kinds of films, not just music videos, which we know quite well, but documentaries, short films and feature films, all because of their love of reggae. So we're going to show you a small number of these films here for the next three Fridays at Emancipation Park. We'll start with the music videos, and the first one is Jamaica Nice. Enjoy. Jamaica Nice, come on the island, what about in Kingston town? Jamaica Nice, listen to my sound, from Paris Street down to Chamda. Jamaica Nice. It's history that it's being shown in Jamaica on a screen for the first time. It's history because it's the first music video made in Jamaica. 007 Shantytown was a big hit for Desmond Dekker. It was a big hit not just in Jamaica, but abroad, especially in Britain. In Britain, it was in the top of the pops for several weeks.
Roots forever music, breaking the chains, setting captives free, and like the rock of Gibraltar.
The National Library is actually now positioned to develop a portal which will showcase a digital reggae film archive. The creation of such an archive will improve our ability to safeguard these important films which document Jamaica's rich musical history.
The first film was made in Jamaica in 1908, Daughter of the Gods. And Jamaica has a storied history, if you will. Jamaica also had one of the oldest film acts that was promulgated in 1945. Jamaica's Film Commission was promulgated in 1984. One of the things that you're going to be seeing over the next couple weeks are the number of documentary films that are made outside of Jamaica by non-Jamaicans. I want you to become interested in documenting the lives of the people around you, and not just in taking selfies, but in researching and documenting lives. In the last 2 years, we have lost over 35 Jamaican entertainers. And their stories also have become lost. And so I want to evoke that sense of actually creating and making stories and documenting that.
The messengers of reggae. What follows is a trip down reggae lane through the eyes of those who have been moved by it.
At the supermarket was made for a competition called Make a Film in 24 Hours. And you're going to be very surprised to see the film that was made in just 24 hours with no budget, just getting together from tonight till tomorrow night.
Hi,
I've always loved reggae music because it's, to me, it's very spiritual, it's very profound. And I'm here tonight just to get more knowledge about the beginnings of reggae music and the history of it. I think a lot of people love reggae, they're interested in reggae, and the best way to promote that is through film.
It's our history, it's our music, you know, and it's the biggest thing that the Western Hemisphere has given to the world to date. You know, and I think if we don't seize the opportunity, you know, to control it, you know, we might lose it. It's good. It's good because that's one of the best ways to kind of preserve the history of reggae in the archives.
And I believe that things like this helps us to remind us of our roots, of where we're from. And, you know, as they say, you know, if you don't know your roots or you don't have no roots, you really can't grow, you know?
Go with the children, friends and relatives. The Reggae Films Showcase continues this Friday to close out February.
Has given the world at least six musical genres. One of the most popular is reggae. Synonymous with music is dance. And Jamaicans have created dance moves to go with almost every musical genre created. Up next, we take you to the dance floor, looking back at some of the steps that have helped to create the dances we have today.
To the country's motto, out of many one people, Jamaica's indigenous dance movement is a rich mix of African, European, Spanish, and several other ethnic influences. A shoulder movement from the British, hip roll from the Africans, and so on. All gyrations and synchronized rhythmic stepping, locals have merged to birth new dance styles.
Indigenous means that it was created here. It's native to the space. I call some things indigenous formalized. They're indigenous. And all these indigenous things, you know, like, for example, gere, they say it's a creolized form. Now, when you say creolized form, that means some of it was shaped here. So then it becomes indigenous. So there are quite a few others.
Brookings reveals a unique mixture of African and European influences. The Brookings Party is a stately, dipping, gliding dance typified by the thrust and recovery action of the hip and leg.
So, for example, Brookings, you cannot go back to Africa and find Brookings. Remember, Brookings was a celebration for the abolition of slavery in this country called Jamaica. And there's a long story behind that.
So that position happens in Brookings. All right, get up. But she no do it all the way. When them do it, you know, it's all down upon the ground and the back and back.
This band of masqueraders scare a few, especially children. Some persons are definitely not in favor of one of the characters, the devil. John Kunu goes as far back as slavery, but at that time, the bands were very large and elaborate. The musicians would play tunes of well-known traditional songs on the fife, accompanied by bass and rattling drums, shakas and graters. Their primary dance movement is the prance,
behaving wildly as they try to evoke fun or mockery.
Music is a great, great sound. Jamaica's first international.
What you're seeing down across is arms that come out of Jankuno, come out of our ancient forms as well. And so you see those arms in Skia. Those same arms. Where did it come from? It have to come anywhere from sky. It come from our ancestral memories, our heritage, and it bleed beautifully into modern day times, into what we call popular dance.
Dancehall in the 1960s, a popular dance then was the ska. Oh yes, skanking was the movement partygoers would do to the rhythm of the similar name, ska punk or hardcore punk. Jamaica's first international.
When people say they're dancing bingi, also indigenous. Any movement that you see people do in Rastafari, because Rastafari, and it's not only dance.
That's right. Rastafarianism is a religion and it has its own dance.
Although African Kumina has been here for so long, it is a tradition in this space. Kumina was not created here. It is Kikongo. In the language they speak, free Africans and enslaved Africans, the more they came, brought that tradition, that religious tradition, to the space. But over time, because that is from 18 something, you know, it becomes traditional to the space because it's constantly here. Dance hall is indigenous. Anything out of everything in dance hall is indigenous. And so everybody should be saying, anybody who dances dance hall should mention Jamaica. Because Jamaica is who created that cultural space that has in it dance. Dance hall goes right back to Africa. And if you go online now and you look at Africans doing dance hall, there's a slightly different flavor to it. But there's a use of bottom, there's a use of, the use is similar. So some things, you know, are what Kamau Brathwaite, the writer from Barbados, says, tide electric, in that the tides of the ocean bring it to come, and sometimes the tides of the ocean carry it back. So if you look at dancehall, you know, the ocean bring all of this African, and then sometimes you see it carry back, and dancehall is in Africa now, as African dancehall. In dance, it's a forward movement where we decide to be Caribbean-centric. So now we're not necessarily Afrocentric or Eurocentric. We are now. We have now created a space of our voice. We are Caribbean-centric in the movements that we create. From the time of ska that you mentioned, all the way up now to dancehall.
And this is the final stop in today's magazine. Thanks so much for journeying with us. As we go, we implore you to stay connected through our website, jis.gov.jm, or on our YouTube channel. And while you're online, send your feedback to jamaicamagazine@jis.gov.jm or on our social media pages. On behalf of the production crew, I'm Audrey Williams. Have an airy weekend.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.